Greetings once again, everybody. It's a blessing to be with you all once again. We thank God for just the opportunity to come together in this session to be able to pray together and also to communicate God's word together. We're grateful and thankful for those who are in-house. There are others, again, who are watching by way of YouTube and Facebook and the like. And so we're grateful, as I said, for just this opportunity. I want to pause and just go to God in prayer for just the moments that we have at this particular time, and just thanking God again for just being the gracious God he is, for loving us the way he loves us, cares about us the way he cares about us. And so we just want to intercede on behalf of some of our brothers and our sisters on today. Our Father, once again, we are thankful and grateful to you for the blessing of life, and to know that life is really centered in Jesus Christ. He is the one who declared, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father other than by me." And so, God, we are thankful for the gift of Jesus. We thank you for the grace of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the truth that is found in Jesus. It reminds us in the book of John, full of grace and truth, the epitome of who you are, the personalization of who you are, is found in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so we thank you for Jesus, because we recognize that in Jesus he just makes life so much better, makes life so much able to comprehend and to understand things just a whole lot better. And so God, we recognize that we fall short. And so we admit again our sins, we confess our own sins before you, asking, Lord, that you would forgive us for those things that we do that are contrary to your will, your way, and your word. For those times in life, much as we talked about Adam, act independent of you, for those times in life that we can do like Cain, being different about you. But God, I pray that you would help us to live like Abel, to be intentional about pleasing you. So Lord, we intentionally come today to confess our sins. We intentionally come at this time to remind ourselves of our need for you. Lord, we ask that you would cleanse us of our unrighteousness. So on behalf again of the members of the Good Shepherd Church, we lay before you, Lord, our own concerns that we do have. We pray for Brother Callahan, who is still grieving the death of his wife, the burial of his wife. We ask, Lord, your grace and your mercy continue to be on him. We pray for Sister Chandler, who is grieving, again, the death of her son that is going to be buried on this coming week. Father, we lift them before you. And again, just pray your grace and your mercy continue to be in each of their lives. We thank you, God, for Glenda. We thank you, God, for those who've been in and out of the hospital, that you've delivered them and you've allowed them to recover. And we thank you so much for that reality. We pray for Brother Wynn today. You know his situation and his circumstance better than I ever could. For Kendra's uncle, for Malika's grandfather. We pray your blessings upon him, Lord, as in hospice care. And I ask again, you continue to be God. Continue to be good in his life. Grant him what he needs at this hour. Be with that family, Lord, as they stand beside him to help him in these moments and minutes of life. Even when he feels a bit despondent and a bit depressed, Lord, we ask again that you would lift him up as only you are able to do. Thank you for Keith and his continued contribution with his uncle to help uplift his spirit. God, we do pray again for Sister Philomena Thomas and everybody in between, for the babies that are yet in mom's belly. We pray you continue to allow us again to be the church that you've made us to be, God. We thank you for all of our members that are recovering from various illnesses, sicknesses, and disease. You know them so much better than we know them. For Sister Bertha, we pray again for Larry Henry. We know the situations that are going on with Sister Almira, Sister Paul, all of our members, Lord, who are just going through seasons of difficulty and sickness, disease. But we thank you for the recoveries that have taken place, Lord. For Charlene doing better, thank you for Elvin Skinner doing better. Thank you again for everybody that you're meeting the needs of our lives. We pray for our country, Lord. We're still in this pandemic. We pray for the transition again of our president. We ask, Lord, that you would help him to be the president that he needs to be. Help him to have success as any president should as it relates to his responsibility for the people of the United States of America. Father, we do pray for our world. We pray again that souls might still be saved. We pray, God, for people that are hurting, people that are depressed. We pray for people that are being oppressed. We thank you for those. We pray for those persons who losing their lives, families that are crying right now because of somebody going to church, somebody reading the Bible, somebody singing a hymn of the church, and that loved one now has lost their life because of that. So, Lord, we lift all of these persons before you. We pray for our own sister, Carolyn Ben. You know the struggle that's going on with Carolyn right now, God. We know you got all power, and we know you can do anything. So just like you've been doing the last 3 years in her life, God, we ask that you continue to be God for the next 3 hours. And then as it goes on, the next 3 days, the next 3 months, as you would see fit, Lord. And then we do pray for Horace, and we thank you, God, for his continued courage and support and to show us again what it means in sickness and in health, for better or for worse, to be able to maintain those vows that you that he made many, many years ago. God, we pray that you will be with us now in the study of your word, that you would open our hearts and our minds and help us to receive the things, Lord, that are important to you. We do pray for the people in Birmingham, Alabama, that went through the tornado just recently, Father. Thank you for Daniel and for his family being protected. And we do pray for those persons that are crying, the persons that are hurting right now because of a family member that's no longer with them. We ask again you continue to meet the needs in the midst of pandemics, in the midst of protests, in the midst of political unrest. Lord, give us your peace that surpasses all understanding, that which will guard our hearts and our minds. And God, we're going to be careful to give you the glory. We're going to be careful to give you the praise. We're going to be very careful to give you all the honor, because it does belong to you and you don't share it with anybody else. We pray these things now in Jesus' name. And for his sake, we pray it. Amen. Once again, just welcome to our prayer time and our Bible study. As I said on last a couple of weeks ago, just wanted to ask us if we would to go back to the lesson that we had on getting your house in order. Basically, that's kind of a theme that we're dealing with, a series that we're dealing with right now. And if you call remember January 13th, which was 2 weeks ago today, we were looking at the issue of God ordered the order of his creation. We were looking at how things, God put things in order. God spoke, and everything that we know to be, he put it in order. We understood he had what God ordered, limits on everything he ordered other than himself. Again, it was an extension of the sermon that we had done on the second Sunday. And so we're just getting these reminders to us that God is a God of order. As we do know, you know, right now is the football season, and you know, many times when you're watching the come out of a huddle, and a huddle says we're getting ready to run a play, but then after they run the play and they come to the line, they are establishing order. But you notice every now and then somebody on the offensive side will move. And they say what they call it illegal motion, meaning that at that point, when it was just a little jump, that person right now is out of order. On the other side, on the defensive side, they call it encroachment, because now that person has gone into a territory that they should not have gone into, even though it's only 6 inches. It's encroachment, because now that person is what? He is being penalized because he was what? Considered out of order, because these things have been put in place. And then we looked at God created what? Everything he created to do what he ordered it to do. The Bible talks about that after God made everything, the Bible says that God blessed them. That's in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 through 28. Verse 28, it says, God blessed them. God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that what? That creeps on the earth. And so God had an expectation that humanity that he created, watch this, on the sixth day would be the one that would ultimately have the dominion over everything, excuse me, y'all, that God created. I am struggling with my allergies these days, I tell you. And so now, what I want to do is with that last sheet that I gave you all on number three, basically what we want to look at is just kind of listing out, looking out throughout the epochs of time in terms of history, how God determined the order. So you got four lines there, and if you got some blank lines, but again, what we're going to be looking at is the original order, first of all, was established by God. The original order of things, the way God wanted them to be, was number one, was established by God. So on top of that, I just need you to write Genesis 1, 26 through 28. That's without that, that would be that blank there. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 to 28. Just for our edification, let's turn to that. That was the premise passage that we had. But I just want us to see that, just to see how it works for us. God is establishing that order, and we want to maintain and always remember the original order that God established. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 through verse 28. And it says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." So when you think about it, think about how much God valued humanity, that God would actually give humanity dominion over everything that he created other than himself. All the birds, the fish of the sea, the cattle, every creeping thing, man has dominion over that. And as a result of having dominion, it also constitutes responsibility. God expects us what? To do what? To take care of what he created. He expects us to have dominion over, to rule over, to reign over it, but that also means that we gotta take care of what it is. It's no different, again, than a parent with a child. You rule over that child, but you also have what? Responsibility for the child that you rule over. The reality is that President Biden has now just become what? The 46th president of the United States of America. He has a certain level of rulership as far as America is concerned, but he's also showing, like we're hearing right now, what he wants to do with the vaccines. We're hearing right now of the executive orders that he is signing. He is also showing that he has responsibility for the people that he, quote unquote, has rule over. Again, trying to push for another stimulus check, where he recognizes there are a lot of people that are hurting. And so he's trying to provide a little bit more economic resources, because though he rules over the nation of the United States of America as the president of the United States, he also what has responsibility to take care of what he rules over. All right, so we recognize it's God who established the original order. The original order was established by God. The second thing that we're looking at is that the original order was exchanged. The original order was exchanged by humanity. That line there, you're going to write Genesis 3, verse 1 through 24. The original order was exchanged by humanity. And of course, that's really the whole chapter of Genesis chapter 3. So we're not gonna read all of that. Everybody know that. We got the situation that they're in the garden, right? And they come to the garden, and the Bible says, and I'm gonna just look at a couple of verses, maybe verse 1 starting there. "Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, 'Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?' And the woman said to the serpent," oh Lord, see we got some disorder that's taking place, right? The serpent was more cunning, God, than any beast that God had made. And he said to the woman, he said now to the woman, "Has God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, nor shall you touch it, lest you what?" Then the serpent said to the woman, here come the disorder. You shall not, you shall not surely die. Now again, we just read, what did God say? God said, you will die. Don't eat from the tree, you will die. Now we've got somebody else that's saying something other than what God said. Listen, that's a lesson for us. Anytime we hear people say something different than what God has given us in his word, it's not hard to figure out if that person is out of order. It don't take long to figure that out. It's out of order. And watch this. It'll make the difference who they are. They can be pastor, reverend, bishop, apostle, whoever it may be. If they say anything contrary to what God has said, guess what? It's out of order. So now, just a simple lesson for us. You know, we hear things all day long. We read things all day long. There are many of you that, you know, you're on Twitter, you may be on Facebook, you do something with Snapchat, you do those kinds of things. You listen to the news, you listen. You know, I don't know about you all, but during the time of the issues that were going on with President Trump, and you would listen to Fox News, and you listen to CNN, the same situation, they got a total different twist on the same situation. And I'll be looking at it and say, all of y'all out of order, just totally out of order, because rather than telling the truth, you're giving your slant. And you know, I often say this, y'all have heard me say this many, many times. I feel like I've got one of the easiest jobs in the world, because all I got to do is repeat what God said. I got to study it, though. I got to study it. But then at the end of the day, all I need to do is repeat what God said. Now watch this. Whether people like it or not, that's really not the issue for me. The issue is God said it. So now what you going to do? You know, when God says stuff to us like, you know what I often talk about in Luke 6, love your enemies. People say, I ain't there yet. Hey, whether you there or not, God said it, and it don't change how God gonna look at it just because you're not there yet. Or I'm not there yet. It doesn't change anything about God. And so anything that I do different than that, I'm what? I'm out of order. So now, God wanted man to have what? Dominion, right? Over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over every living thing that creeps upon the earth. So now, what happens? Verse 6, the woman saw, right? Verse 7, their eyes were open. Verse 8, they heard the sound of the Lord. Verse 9, then the Lord God called to Adam, said to him, where you at? Not like God didn't know. He wanted Adam to confess. Where you at, man? At this point, Adam is not in the right relationship with God. So now, disorder has been brought to the world. So that original dominion that he has, that original dominion is no longer there. Because watch this. Here is what you had, right? Remember the serpent. The Bible says that man was to have a dominion over everything God had created, the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and all of the creatures, the cattle, and the creeping things, correct? All right? So now you have the serpent, which eventually we find out is Satan, who is now talking to the woman and giving the woman an order. Watch this. While she ate from the tree, verse 6 actually says, at the end of the verse, she also gave to her husband with her. So you got now the lower creation, which is the serpent, talking to the woman who has dominion, but the man is right there silent, and both of them now is no longer listening to God. So now what you have? You have God, you got man and woman working together, you got the lower creation, but now you got disorder. The lower creation is telling those who ought to have dominion what to do, how to think, and now they're listening and not listening to God. That's out of order. So whenever God establishes an order in a home, whatever God says that is right for that home, that's what it ought to be. Think y'all have heard me say it before. If a man who is in his house stay silent about what's going on in his house, that's out of order. If a woman can move that neck and tell a man, you ain't gonna tell me what to do, that's her husband, guess what? That's out of order. If the parents tell a child to do something and the child don't move, guess what? That's out of order. If you go to work and you're telling your boss how to run his business, I'm just telling you, that's out of order. Because God is the one who has established that order, so anything that goes against what God has said is now out of order. So what happened? The original order was exchanged by humanity. And what happens? Anytime we exchange God's truth, what do we get in return? A lie. If you exchange God's truth, you automatically got a lie. Because once you don't have truth, you ain't got nothing. And the only thing opposite of truth is what? A lie. Romans chapter 1 talks about that. The moment you exchange God's truth and you're watered down, you say, well, God didn't really mean. No. He mean what he say. He say what he mean. He puts it very, very plainly. Every now and then we see a little gray area. You're trying to like, I'm not really sure. You know, and so you kind of got to discuss it. But most of the stuff God says is pretty plain. So now they are now out of order. So what happens? They got to get kicked out of the garden. So that dominion that they once had, that dominion has now been affected. Because remember what they were created with, the very image of God, the very likeness of God. So now they can no longer rule the way God originally intended for them to rule. But watch this. It didn't stop the fact that God still expected them to rule. They messed up, but it doesn't mean that God, because remember, God made the declaration that humanity was to have dominion over everything that he created, and just because they messed up didn't mean that God didn't expect it. All right, so let's look at this third one. The original order was still expected as expressed in song by David. Here's what I need you to do. Write this. Psalm 8, 1 through 9. Psalm 8, 1 through 9. Psalm 8, 1 through 9. And once you write that down, I'm going to ask that you would turn in your Bibles or scroll in your Bibles to Psalm chapter 8. God's original order. God's expectation as far as original order is concerned. And so David writes, and when David writes, David is writing, I'm going to say it this way, some 900 years before the birth of Jesus. Visit him. Notice verse 5. You have made him lower than the angels, and you have crowned him what? With glory and honor. Notice again what he says in verse 6. What is the glory and honor that he had? Is the fact that he's created what? In the very image and likeness of God, and God has given man the right. He gave man the right to rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the cattle, and every creeping thing that was on the earth. Notice what he says in verse 6. You have made him, You have made him to do what? You've made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet. What things are you talking about, Lord? All the sheep and oxen, even the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea that pass through the paths of the sea. So David has to extol and just praise the Lord. And he says, oh, Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. You gave us that kind of dominion, and you gave us that kind of responsibility. You gave us that kind of privilege. Lord, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I think I told you all this before. In the 90s, I went to the Shepherd's Conference with Dr. John MacArthur. And Pastor Mike Boston and I were guests. They had literally taken 3 John. They took 3 John literally, where the Bible would say that you are to, they would open their house for what they call itinerant preachers. And that was a couple. That couple then had to be their late, I'm just going to say early 60s, mid 60s, you know. They opened up their house and allowed 2 African-American preacher pastor to live in their house. Never met us before. We never met them, but we stayed in their house. We're there, I think we got there on a Wednesday, so we're there Wednesday night, Thursday night. I think Pastor Boston had to leave Friday, so I'm there Friday night. And I never shall forget, Saturday, the people said, Lee, we're getting ready to go to some event that we're going to, and so would you be okay staying by yourself? I'm thinking, yeah, I guess. I mean, in my mind, I'm thinking, do y'all want me to leave? I mean, it seems like y'all would maybe say, you know, you're going to have to leave for a little while and come. No, so and watch this. And then say it to me, look, if you want to go somewhere, we'll leave you the keys to one of our cars. I'm thinking, okay. Now, this is interesting. You know, and so after they left, I was curious. I'm thinking, they leaving me a car. I go in the garage and look, because, you know, I had the freedom to do that. They left me the new car. I'm thinking, oh, my God. So we're in California. I mean, these people are apparently well off. I mean, it's got swimming pool in the back, and they tell, hey, man, enjoy yourself. You know, just if you want to, you go in the swimming pool, just enjoy yourself. And I'm thinking, oh, my goodness. And I say that because this is the kind of dominion that God had given Adam and Eve. I got all of this for y'all to enjoy. It's a privilege for you to be over my world. I'm giving you privilege over the cattle, over the creeping things, over the fish, over the bird. All I'm telling y'all, just don't blow it. So I'm in that house thinking, I don't want to blow this, man. You know, so now I don't want to mess up nothing. I don't want nothing to fall over. I want to make sure I am properly representing who I need to be representing, right? Because the expectation was that we are giving you, watch this, for all intents and purposes, right now you've got a little dominion in our house. Now, I understood who the house belonged to. But they had now given me responsibility for that house. You get what I'm saying? So when we think about the responsibility that God has given you, I have given you a wonderful life. I have given you, most of you got to admit, you have a wonderful life. My grace, my mercy, my joy. We often talk about that in the building where we are. The love, the joy, the peace, the long-suffering, the kindness, the goodness, the faithfulness, the meekness, the self-control. We got all of that. You got the Holy Spirit living in you. And all I'm saying, just don't blow it. So, but every now and then, we got to be reminded these are the things that God would say to us in order for us to be getting our house in order. Because we have to admit, there are times, y'all, we just get out of order. And even though we're out of order, God's expectation of us doesn't change. So now, they still, when David writes this, and remember, David writes this under the unction of the Holy Spirit, so the things that he is writing is what God wanted him to write, that is clearly understood. I'm going back to verse 6 one more time. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep, oxen, even the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea that pass through the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Well, here is the deal. Now, it takes us to the last thing. The original order, even though that's an expectation, right? The original order was effectively experienced in the Lord Jesus Christ. The original order was effectively experienced in the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, write that down. And here's, I'm sorry, you want to, this is the passage. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1 through 18. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1 through 18. Just write that down. And once you do that, I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bibles or scroll in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2, 1 through 18. And then I want y'all to pay attention to see, because at some point, you're going to hear the passage that we just read. So now remember, God writes this in the beginning. We're talking thousands of years later. The Holy Spirit moves and is moving in David in such a manner that God reminds us again of what God originally intended for us, even though we blew it in the garden. We messed it up in the garden. We gave up some of the dominion that we had in the garden, but God still expected us to have the dominion. And now here it is. Jesus Christ has already come. Jesus Christ has already died. He's already been buried in a grave. He's already been resurrected. And now God is saying the same thing. Watch now. Therefore, look at chapter 2, verse 1. Therefore, we must give the more earnest heed to the things we've heard, lest we drift away. For if the word spoken through angels proves steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience receive the just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed by us, was confirmed to us by those who heard it? God also bearing witness with both signs and wonders, with various miracles, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. God, who bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts, Holy Spirit, according to his own will. Now notice he gives us the answer. Verse 5. For he has not put the world to come of things which we speak in subjection to angels. Wow. Because remember what we got in the book of Hebrews, you got folk who had embraced Jesus Christ, but when persecution and oppression had come, they kind of backed away from Jesus rather than embracing Christianity totally. They were now doing Judaism. They had gone back to church observing the synagogue, going back to Mosaic law and all of that kind of thing. And it was reminding them, hey, man, when you already got Jesus, you already got the best. Don't shy away from Jesus. So now he has to remind them, you're going back to worship something again. Definitely. The angels had a prominent responsibility in the confirmation of the covenant that God had given. Because remember, when you look at the Ark of the Covenant, in the mercy seat, what was above it? You had two angels where their wings were touching, symbolizing again what the very presence of God, and God again utilizing ministering angels, if you would, to watch over the nation of Israel. When they come out of Egypt, remember, the Bible says that the angel of God went before them and put what? Darkness for the Egyptians and light for the Israelites. So the angelic realm was absolutely involved in the history, if you would, of Israel. But he's saying, wait a minute, now that you got Jesus, don't go back to something secondary. You've already got the best. Don't go back to something secondary, right? So now he reminds him. Verse 5, for he has not put the world to come, which we speak and subject unto angels. But one testified in a certain place saying, and here's the language, y'all. What is man? What is man that you are mindful of him? Or the son of man that you take care of him? You have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor and set him over the works of your hands. you have put all things in subjection under his feet. Remember, where did we just read that? Psalm 8, right? So now it is, thousands of years later, or about 1,000 years plus, he's saying the same thing that he said in the beginning. So watch now. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not to be put under him, but now we do not yet see all things put under him. What is he doing? He's taking us back to what happened in the garden. Man relinquished all of the dominion that we were originally supposed to have. It was relinquished in the garden. But he says now, when we look at humanity, we don't see everything subject to us. We don't have dominion, if you would, in our humanity over everything like God originally had us in Genesis chapter 1, in Genesis chapter 2. We had rule over everything. But we forfeited it. We got deceived through Eve, and we chose to operate independent of God, and we now no longer had that image of God that we were carrying. We lost something in the garden. But I got some good news for y'all. I love it. Think about it. How does it make you feel when you know, as far as you're concerned, you lost something? I know I lost it. Jules just had that experience just the other day. When you just know, you're like, golly, man, I guess. And then you find it, or somebody bring it to you. How you feel? What what kind of joy do you have? You're like, because you're just new in your mind, like, oh, man. You know, and you're doing your best to find it, and you just can't. It just won't come to you. I lost it. And you come to a point like, man, I guess I lost. But here's the good news. Look at it says, for in that he put all in subjection unto him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him. What is he referring to? Humanity. Those of us who come from Adam. I like the first word of verse 9. But. But. We see Jesus. We see Jesus. Now watch this. Notice what happens with Jesus, who was made a little lower than what? Than the angels. Wait a minute. Isn't that what he said about us in verse 7? You have made him a little lower than the angels. What is man that you're mindful of him? Son of man that you visited. You have made him a little lower than the angels, but we see Jesus. Oh, yeah, who was made a little lower than the angels, who was made, I'm sorry, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. That's the good news, y'all. We blew it in the garden, far as humanity was concerned, but God always had us in his mind, but he had us in his mind through his son, Jesus Christ. Oh, and so now, but in order for that to happen, Jesus had to become like us, made a little lower than the angels. Now, you have to understand, when we look at Jesus, what we think about, we got to think both God and man, fully God, fully man, right? He was absolutely man because he actually became, he was fertilized, conceived by the Holy Spirit in the womb of his mom. So he a baby. When he comes out, he got an umbilical cord that got to be cut. Jesus had a belly button, all right? So that umbilical cord got to be cut. Now, you got the one who holds the world in his hand who's being held. You got the same one who feeds everybody being fed at the breast of his mom. You got the one who takes care of everybody at the same time, got to have his diaper changed. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Ooh, don't run, Larry. I see you want to run. Don't run. Because he is both God and he is man. He had to become like us. Now watch this. So that he might suffer, that's what the word says, for the suffering of death. But notice what happened. Crowned with glory and honor. Wait a minute. So how can he suffer and die and be crowned with glory and honor? Third day. Oh yeah, the dominion is there because what had happened? What had ultimately happened is that God is. Remember, God said in the garden, "The day that you eat from that tree, you will surely die." But God had already made a determination that in Jesus Christ, that thing that caused us to no longer have the dominion that God originally intended for us to have, that thing would actually still exist, but it would now exist in the person of His Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, have mercy, y'all. Think about that. Everything that God intended for us, it never stopped existing, but God, even though it didn't look like we had it, why? Because we look at all the great people of the Bible. Abraham died. Moses died. Isaiah died. Jeremiah died. Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi all died. Joshua died. Aaron died. When you look all throughout, Elijah, Elisha, they all died. And so it looked like we don't have no dominion. But that dominion is still there, but it was always in the person of his son, Jesus Christ. And look how fast Jesus fixed that thing. It took us just a minute to lose our dominion. God give us everything in the garden. We choose to rebel against God. It took us a minute to lose it. And so for thousands of years, people dying. And so it don't look like we got dominion, right? And it took Jesus 3 days. All of that disorder that's been going on, he fixed it all on the third day. Because he got up. And so him getting up would be crowned with glory and honor that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. Now watch this. For it was fitted for him, for whom all things, by whom all things, and bring many sons to glory, to make the captain of their soul perfect through sufferings. In other words, he's speaking about us. For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things, and we understand everything belonged to Jesus. John chapter 1, all things what were made by him and for him. Colossians chapter 1 would remind us of that too. And by him are all things, bringing many sons. And of course, that includes Julia, that includes Diane, that includes the ladies, those of you that are listening right now. That includes all of us who have put our faith, our trust, our confidence in Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. He bringing many sons to glory to make the captain of that salvation perfect through suffering. In other words, it made Jesus complete. We see the completion of everything that Jesus was about. But in order for us to regain that dominion, he had to die on the cross. That dominion had to come through suffering. That again, that ability to rule like God intended for us to rule, which was the last enemy, which was death. The only way we could overcome that was through Jesus Christ. But Jesus Christ had to suffer. Now watch this, y'all. If somebody suffered for us like that, doesn't it make sense for us to follow the order that he's put in place for us? Notice what it says in verse 11. But for both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified, meaning Jesus who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified, are all one. For this reason, he is not ashamed to call them brethren. My goodness. You know, I often think about that. I'll just kind of think about that. You know, sometimes you just, you know, just doing some crazy thinking, you know. If I just, you know, Mars and I go visit other places, whatever, and we just happen to be walking wherever it may be, and, you know, Barack Obama happened to walk up on us, And he look at me and say, "What's up, brother?" I know I'm gonna be stunned. Like, but here's what I'm saying. The former president of the United States, again, a man of authority, man of power, prominence, is referring to me as his brother. And he means it. What we're talking about, Jesus, the only begotten beloved Son of God, because of our belief in him, refers to you and I as his brothers and his sisters. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? That what it's saying is that God has made us heirs of the very thing that he's given to Jesus, the rule, the dominion, the reign, the power that he's given to Jesus. He's also sharing that with us. Yeah, we grew up in a house that you know, for us children were concerned, we had to share everything. Mom and daddy would remind, don't forget that's your brother, that's your sister. You got to share. You got to share with your brothers and sisters. I have to admit, I was kind of a, you know, yeah, I was spoiled. Yeah, I was spoiled. My mama did it. I was spoiled. I don't apologize for it. I'm glad, you know. I was the oldest child, the only son. So there are certain things that went just for the boy. Didn't have to share it, if you will, you know. But most of the time, share that with your sister. Don't forget Sienna. Don't forget Charlene, you know. And regrettably, sometimes I had to, you know, I had to give them some stuff I didn't want to. But Jesus, he wants to share. He wants to give us. He wants us to have it. Now watch again. We got to close. We got to close. Saying, look at verse 12. I declare your name to my brethren. Ooh-wee. Jesus saying to the Father, I declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing praise to you. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, here am I and the children whom God has given me. Again, these prophetic words will come out of Psalms and various things that were said from a standpoint of our humanity. But that was actually the double meaning, where it was also referring to Jesus. We are brothers and sisters of the Lord Jesus Christ, folk. Somebody ought to give him a praise today. We are brothers and sisters of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is not only our Lord and our Savior and our King, he is our big brother. He is our big brother. Yeah, man, I do remember. And they gave me a hard time when we living in 1015 West Beach. Larry and Jeffrey, they gave me a hard time on some stuff. Yeah. Larry probably more so. Jeff was my big brother. Jeff would look out for me, man. Jeff would look out for me, you know. But when, you know, in them crunch times when Larry had to, you know, they used to call me Lee, Lee Chinese. That was, you know, because I kind of had some tight eyes, you know. So that's how they would refer to me. But I'm glad that I knew they had my back. Yeah, I had to worry about nothing. I mean, no matter where we were, many times I played football on the big parking lot over there, Diane, by the Catholic Church, as we played football. You know, I had to worry about nothing, man. I was good because I knew those guys would have my back. Think about it. Our big brother has our back, y'all. Jesus said, I got your back. I got your back. Not only my Lord and your Savior, but I am your brother, and I want to share with you what the Father has given to me. Wow, look at verse 14. Inasmuch then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, meaning Jesus, that through death he might destroy him who had power of death, that is what? The devil. What he just did, he took us back to Genesis 3:15 when he cursed. What he said? He says that I'm going to put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed, her seed, and your seed. You're going to crush his head, he's going to bruise your heel. But notice again what he's showing. In the garden, we transferred the power to Satan. Because now humanity had to die. But God always had a plan that we weren't going to always live with that sentence of death. It would always be overcome ultimately by Jesus. And he says in verse 15, and release those who through the fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Oh, my goodness, I tell you. Before, again, becoming believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we're literally scared of stuff, yeah. You know, kind of always, ooh, you know, wondering. I mean, think about it now. Even as believers, if we're not careful, we don't think about Jesus, we become afraid of stuff. Things that we shouldn't be fearful of. Because the Bible says he's not given a spirit of fear, but of power and of a sound mind. There are times we become afraid. But what he's saying, that God now has taken away the sting of death. And I know when I say this, my wife sometimes, she cringes, like, there you go again. I'm serious. I am not afraid to die. I am so serious when I say that. I am not afraid to die. Because I'm convinced what he said. To be absent from this is to going to be present with the Lord. That's what he did. So he has taken away the sting of death, ultimately what death would lead to, the consequences of being separated from God, what Jesus Christ has done for us in the fact that we've trusted in him as our personal Savior. What he says to us, I understand death is still going to be a part of your reality, but death is not conclusive for you no longer. It's not conclusive. You're going to get up. So now, if we have dominion over death, guess what, y'all? We got dominion over everything else. So God wants us to do what? To operate as though we have that dominion. He would remind us in the world, in the Bible, he says, sin shall not have dominion over you. Oh, yeah, sin shall not have dominion over you. I have to, you know, y'all know I tell y'all that every now and then. I'm struggling a little bit right now. I was doing good. I was doing really good in December. And then, you know, they say I tested positive. Y'all remember that? Most of y'all remember that. And so I was doing really good, man. I'm exercising, doing all of that kind of thing. And December 25th came. I have not recovered from December 25th yet. It's like, oh my God, sin shall not have dominion over you, Lee Skinner. And so, you remember I told y'all that sometimes. Remember that little line for Lay's potato chips? Bet you can't eat just one. But what I told y'all, my issue is bet you can't eat just one bag. Sin shall not have dominion over you. And I've been saying that to myself, Lee, sin shall not have dominion over you. I have to admit, right now I'm not winning that battle very well. I got to get back with it. Because that's the kind of dominion, that's the kind of power God has given us. And I think y'all admit the same thing. We all struggling with something. But God is saying to us, I've given you dominion over that. We as Christians, we should have had dominion over everything Donald Trump said that wasn't the truth. We should have had dominion over that and not allow that to control us. We should have dominion right now, even though President Biden is in office. We should have dominion of knowing that we only in this with him for 4 years. And so it's not what the Democrats will do that will give us what we need. It's ultimately trusting in God. We got dominion over that. He's given us dominion over the coronavirus. Yes, he has. And it ain't got nothing to do with a vaccine. It has everything to do with the victory that Jesus claimed on the cross and got up on Sunday morning. That's where our victory is. Because he's saying, if you die, I'm going to get you up again. If that's the worst thing that can happen to you, I got you there too. Last two verses, and then we're done. Verse 16, three verse, I'm sorry. For indeed he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Isn't that something? We can count on the fact that he's going to help us. Because we look at it, it's the seed of Abraham that God has the promise that he's going to be faithful to. Therefore, in all things he had to be made like his brethren. Woo! Talking about Jesus, y'all. That he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God. Why? To make propitiation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able. Listen to that. He is able to aid those who are tempted. I'm being very transparent right now. And for those of you that are members of this church, some of y'all are saying, well, I ain't going to be a member there no more. That's just too much truth for me. This past weekend, Larry, Mike, Rodney, you know, they've been talking all week about Tom Brady versus Aaron Rodgers. Tom Brady versus, everybody was predicting. Everybody was saying, oh man, Rodgers ready. He got this thing. He got this thing. Man, I'm looking at this stuff and I'm saying, man, Tom Brady gonna win this thing. Just kind of, you know, just in my mind. And I actually told Shug, I said, you know what, Shug? I'm so sure about this. Watch it. I actually said it. I am tempted to make a bet that Tom Brady is going to the Super Bowl. Thought came. It actually came. It came. It was there. It was like, I said, well, I'll be doggone. I'm actually. And then watch this. Thought about a few little extra dollars. I don't know, some of them extra dollars could have been what y'all gave me for the anniversary. I'm not sure. I'm being honest. It's like, you know what? And then I came to my senses. Like, wait a minute, man. I'm literally saying I'm being tempted. I'm saying it. And I had to say, Lord, help me. Lord, just help me get this out of my head. Help me get this out of my mind. This is crazy. And boy, I tell y'all, Sunday afternoon, Diane, when they won, I was like, I said, no, Lord. No, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I didn't do it, but I was tempted. And I'm admitting he had to help me because the thought came to my mind. The Bible says that he aids us in our temptation. Now, again, for those of you that say that y'all can't be members here no more, thank y'all so much for letting me serve y'all. But I'm just trying to be honest with you as a pastor that the temptations are real, but what God is saying that he's given us Jesus to give us the power over temptations. And I would venture to say I'm probably not the only one. I'd venture to say. We all, but the good news is that God through Jesus Christ has given us dominion over no matter what may come up against us. I love that song that we've been singing around here. No matter what I've done, no matter where I've been, God's got me. I love that. That has helped me get through this pandemic, I'm telling you. No matter what I've done, no matter where I've been, no matter what tests I come against, God's got me. And you got to be convinced of that. So I'm just saying to us, getting our house in order requires that we rely on God, that we rely on the strength that he gives us through his son, Jesus Christ, the one to whom that he has given all dominion, all power, and all rule. Father, how we love you and thank you again for Jesus. And I pray that you would help us moving forward to always again be mindful of his presence, to be mindful of his suffering for us, but to also be remindful of his victory on the third day that he rose with all power and all authority. And that no matter what may come up in our life, you have given us dominion over all things. It's to that end, Lord, we say thank you. We give you the honor, the praise, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all until we meet again. Love you. Take care of one another. Keep loving God.